back, it was like two, yeah, about 200, 250. You're right, because they cut back.
Were you? Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Wethersfield Planning and Zoning meeting, March 7th. Would, Rich, you do the roll call for us?
Chairman Harley.
Here.
Vice Chairman Margiotta.
Nope.
Clerk Roberts here, Mr. Hughes, Mr. Oikle.
Here.
Mr. Hammer.
Here.
Mr. Humicki.
Here.
Mr. Dean.
Here.
Mr. Allard.
Here.
Mr. Edwards. Nope. Ms. Antoniak.
Yes.
Mr. Silver.
Here.
Okay.
And Joe just walked in. Good. Okay. So we're up to nine. Both alternates are participating. Item 4.1, an amended site plan, application 1408-03Z, 1078-1091, Silas Dean Highway, the Colvest Group, with a revised parking plan. Would you join us?
Vacation mode. Retirement mode.
Exactly.
You wearing pants?
Good evening. I hope so. Would you take a minute to introduce yourself and give us a rundown on the application?
Absolutely. My name is Peter LaPointe. I'm a project manager for the Colvest Group. We're the owner of the CVS Plaza and the Silas Dean. It's 178 to 190 Silas Dean Highway. It's a CVS building and a multi-tenant retail building that was approved in 2003. The night of the approval, we were asked to eliminate 23 paved parking spaces across the front of the site to expand the green belt between the Silas Dean and the parking area and hold those spaces in reserve until at some point in the future when they would be needed. The parking area right now in front of the multi-tenant building is full for a good portion of every day, despite the fact that there are currently two vacant spaces. The former Pizza Hut is vacant and the yogurt shop is vacant. We now have a signed lease for a Chipotle Mexican grill that will occupy those combined vacant spaces. Our experience with Chipotle in two locations, Enfield and Chicopee, Massachusetts, is they do a very good lunch business. So they're not going to conflict with Starbucks, but they are going to fill up that lot. And if we're full now, we're going to have a problem once they open. So what we are requesting is a site plan modification to add back in the 23 parking spaces that were held in reserve. The scope of work involved in adding the pavement and adding the parking spaces back would include paving, curb, striping, the relocation of one sight light less than 20 feet backward, and landscape improvements. And basically what we would do is replicate the landscaping that was part and parcel of the original approval. And I actually have those, if that helps. This was the original plan from 2003 that showed those 23 parking spaces across the front. And it gives you the plant materials included in the landscape.
We can pass them down for you. Yeah. Take care of it.
And actually, the landscaping is very important to us. We receive a number of compliments every year on the way the landscaping on that property looks. So, The work required would not entail any new site signs, any change to the storm drainage plan, or any change to traffic flow on the site or on and off the site. It's simply the addition of 23 parking spaces across the front.
Questions for the applicant?
Yeah.
I'd like to see if we can comment from Peter first, if you don't mind. About Peter's memo? Because I, do you mind?
Sure, no, of course.
You don't mind?
No. So as was mentioned, the applicant submitted the plans from circa 2003. So you'll see a memo from the town engineer and myself basically concurring that prior to construction, that a revised signed, stamped, sealed site plan with the appropriate engineering is submitted to staff before construction can commence. He'd like to see some fine elevations to make sure the drainage is going to work. We'd like to see the final landscaping plan. As was mentioned, the light pole has to be moved, and it may or may not conflict with one of the existing trees out there. The only other observation I had is that if you've been to this Starbucks in the morning, the line can be pretty substantial, and those couple of spaces on the, I guess, the southwest corner may or may not come into conflict, but I think that's only for a limited period in the morning. So for the majority of the day, when Chipotle might be creating the demand in the parking, it shouldn't be a problem with the queue for the Starbucks coffee business. So I think as was noted, this expanded parking plan was anticipated at some point in time, as the condition from 2003 indicated, that at the appropriate time, if they feel the demand warrants it, that they could come back in and ask for the additional parking. The only thing that also that I noted is, unfortunately, the employees are not parking in the back, as was hoped. That is a difficult and challenging thing to get some of the tenants to do, but nevertheless, I think the plan, as was originally indicated, as long as the landscaping is recreated as shown on the original plan, I think we would be fine with that.
Thank you.
Thanks.
George?
Yeah. You have a future ATM shown?
Yes, it was contained in the original.
Is that coming out now because you got this new?
It's being moved as a future walk-up ATM to one of the landscaped islands, which is actually where it was moved when the 23 spaces were eliminated.
Oh.
It's never been built.
So in other words, you're eliminating all of those back of the beginning of that turn, that right turn after you come in there. In other words, okay.
The 23 spaces across the front were eliminated in 2003 and held in reserve.
No, that part I understand. I'm talking about the second row.
We're not eliminating anything on the second row. That landscape, that island ATM, I think, is shown on a... it's shown on a landscaped island. And it's only there, and it was asked for originally, on the off chance that we end up with a bank as a tenant. We don't have the ability to give the bank a drive-through. So if we had a bank or a credit union as a tenant, we could give them a walk-up ATM out in the parking lot. We can't give them a drive-through.
Okay, I hear you. Now, this is your landscaping plan
That is the landscaping plan from the original 2003 submission, and it is in fact what we installed when we built the site, and what we are proposing to replicate.
You're just moving it back.
I would argue that those things are mature and could be moved back, but I'm told that's not going to happen. So.
Yeah, you can't do that. Yeah, I see what you're doing, and. Peter, you feel that the Starbucks coming in that southerly entry driveway will be, might interrupt a lot of those parking spaces, the 8 parking spaces on the south side?
Well, just for the record, there won't be 8 spaces there. There'll be 5.
5.
The first 3 closest to the entrance, you required to be eliminated completely. So this was the plan that was in front of the commission at the night of approval. It isn't the final revised plan. But in any scenario, that 8 really should be 5 now. So the first 3 closest to the turn were removed. You guys were obviously concerned that if someone's coming into the parking, they're making a sharp right turn. If someone was backing out of those spaces, there could be a conflict. So rightfully so, those were eliminated. My only observation was if somebody was parked in there, they might just be jammed up in the spaces for a little while as the queue dissipates. But I don't think when those spaces would be in highest demand, is the times probably won't conflict.
I think that's an issue.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think Chipotle is lunch and dinner versus Starbucks, which is, you know, early in the morning as people are on their way to work. There are busy times also during the day, but that queue, I think, typically is, you know, in the morning.
I don't mean to suggest that you don't do right turns. I wouldn't say that in front of all of the civil engineers that normally sit on this commission. But that entry driveway there that we're talking in the same area, I almost think it should shear off some of the southerly corner of it. So it's kind of narrowish when you come in there, based upon my little experience with it. I don't go into Starbucks every day, that's for sure. But, you know, a lot of people do. I don't know. Maybe not.
It is narrow coming up, and that's we actually have discussed that. And one of the things it does is slow people down.
It's traffic calming.
And we would like to slow people down before they get into the parking lot.
Well, good answer on that one.
Right.
Can I?
So you don't basically see, guys, any congestion with putting these spaces in where people are backing out. And that includes either entryway coming into it.
Well, if I can add on to that, my only comment on those 5 spaces is, so we eliminated 3 of them, but we still have the one that's closest to the wood, to the guardrail.
Guardrail, yeah.
Do we need to keep that one, or can we shift the 5 away from that a little bit? Because nobody's going to be able to pull in or get out from that entrance. So, like, just something I wanted to throw out. I don't know if that was part of the original discussion.
No, it was just those first 3. So, but obviously, okay, if you feel so inclined, I was also going to note that guardrail looks like it was hit by snowplow or something. It's cracked. Oh, but
it's an annuity for the fence contract.
There you go.
Well, I would suggest that you take the 5 and you shift it one space
over,
so that somebody who's in that end spot can, or you just do 6, but you hash out the side one, and then, you know, if it's really busy, somebody can park in there.
I did meet with John Zurich from Megson and Hegel yesterday afternoon after talking to the town engineer, and the way we left this, what he was going to do, his survey of that area, so we've confirmed everything, a layout for me, a construction drawing for me, and a final construction drawing for the town engineer's review and approval. And we can include massaging that parking layout so that they're not up against the guardrail at the same time.
My only other question on the parking is it all graded up towards the Silestine?
It's going to pitch a little bit up toward the Silestine, so it all sheet drains back into the parking lot toward the existing catch basins. And that was always the intent.
And along his same lines, have you answered the town engineer's concerns and general grading drainage?
I did. I met with him yesterday. We discussed that there is no change to the drainage system at all. He was also concerned that those parking spaces would drain backwards. That's a function of grading. My CAD guy was actually putting spot elevations in there, but we're going to basically leave that to Megson and Hegel and let them tell us what elevations we have to achieve.
So it's going to be a weep off then?
Yes. Not into the grass. It's going to go backward into the storm, into the lot, into the storm drain system, and then to the detention system at the back of the property before it outfalls backwards into the wetlands.
Joe?
Yeah, I guess I'm going back to the condition 12 of the original approval, which basically says, you know, with the understanding that based upon, I think it meant to say prospective future retail users, the applicant may obtain the approval of the commission as conditions warrant. And I guess I'm focused a little bit on Peter's finding that it didn't appear that the CVS employees were parking. And I'm also coming under the premise that as it stands, they've got twice as many parking spaces as the zoning regulations require. And I think our intent at the time was to try to maintain as much green space as we could. So if CVS employees are not parking in the back, I guess one question is, if they did, would that address the issue without needing all of these spaces? And a related question is, if you've got a tenant going into the Starbucks retail building, you know, these spaces are really far away from that tenant space. So I'm just sort of questioning how attractive they really are to serve that space. And I guess I'll just add to it, I have some concern. I just think you're making it a lot busier, you know, with the 5 and with the 18, and now you've got people backing out of spaces on both sides of what I think is a fairly active 24 foot wide passageway, and it's just creating a lot more room for conflict, you know, than we already have on that site. So those are my comments, but I would be interested in why you can't make do with what you have if the employees are directed to go to the back, and, you know, why these spaces are so vital to the new tenant.
CVS doesn't have 23 employees on any one shift, so even if all of the CVS employees were to park in back, it wouldn't offset these additional spaces. The reality of life is the CVS employees, most of whom are younger or female, don't really want to park behind the store at the back of the lot. They want to park in front in the well-lit parking lot where there's lots of other people and lots of other activity. To your other point, you're correct that the spaces are remote from the Chipotle restaurant, but the parking area is provided for both employees and patrons. And if it were my store, I would tell my employees to park in the most remote spot. Don't park in front of the front door. The front door is for customers. And so this provides the additional parking capacity to accommodate both the employees and the patrons.
Yeah, again, I guess I've been out there quite a bit. I know everybody probably has. I guess I don't really recall ever seeing it where, you know, it was jam packed and there were no spaces available. So
available on the CVS side. The point we were making is the spaces in front of the multi-tenant retail building were at capacity or close to capacity, at least for a portion of every business day over the last 6 months or so. And if we're bringing, and that's with two empty spaces, if we're bringing in a tenant that we know is going to generate a good lunch crowd, then we want to do whatever we can do to accommodate those people.
You know what the peak time is of the CVS operation during the day, or peak times?
The peak CVS? For CVS? I'm assuming 8:30 to 9:30 or 7:30 to 9:30 in the morning. I'm assuming right after work. And I know this CVS peaks at lunchtime because I've been there at lunchtime.
How many of your Chipotle customers are takeouts? I mean, they go in and do a takeout, which is the way I do it in Glastonbury over there.
I have no idea what percentage are.
But I'm not sure.
None of the Chipotles I've seen or we've discussed building have ever asked for a drive-through. So they want you to come into the store. Yeah. The one in Enfield seems to do mostly sit-down business and not a lot of pickup. The one we have in Chicopee does pick up, but they're Air Force people from the Air Force Base, Westover Air Force Base. But they both do a land office lunch business.
By the way, I do want to comment, and this has doesn't reflect my feeling about how I vote here, but I'm pleased you're locating, and I think you picked the best darn location in Wethersfield, and then probably in the region west of the river. There isn't a Chipotle up in Hartford, is there, on Airport Road or anything up in the south?
I don't think so, no.
Glastonbury is the closest. In fact, I asked someone who would know.
Glastonbury, I guess, is the closest.
Newington, I think, too.
The only other one is down Berlin Turnpike. Glastonbury.
Other questions?
I would hope you'd try to clarify that all the employees from Starbucks, CVS, and Chipotle park in the back, additional lighting of some type. My experience with all three, especially Starbucks and Chipotle, is that they're very active. I think it's a great compliment to the town of Wethersfield. I think you've got your challenges with people ordering more online on the, you know, with the drive-through with Starbucks. That line has gone, when I've gone through it, from 2 to 3 on an average to, you know, in an early morning time, up to 6 to 7 people. People are really active. It's a great plaza. I stop at CVS very often, and it is a challenge. I'm in support of this effort, but maybe better lighting and maybe some compliment to get the employees in the back, I think, would be a great plum for that and eliminate some of the issues that we were talking about here with people backing out. And, I mean, I think your problem might be a really good gross earning sales for all three businesses that you have there. I think it's a good plum for the town.
I did happen to take a drive in the back where the employees should be parking before I came to the meeting, and it did seem that there was adequate lighting there. It just seems remote because, you know, you're not visible, so I could understand
why
some of the employees.
We've added lighting back there.
I thought it was fine. Yeah. I think it's just more that there isn't any traffic coming through there, and you're not visible
right
there. So you'd have to use, like, the buddy system or something if you're going to your car. But as far as lighting goes, I thought it was sufficient.
Yeah, I mean, I guess my impression is probably similar to Joe's, that, you know, it's not that there isn't enough parking, it's that there isn't enough parking within 30 feet of where the people want to be. And, you know, at first blush, it struck me as kind of alarming that, you know, the demand for parking would be twice what our regulations require, you know, and it sort of made me wonder whether there was something clearly wrong with our regulations. But I think, you know, it may be something clearly wrong with the, you know, the tenant mix and the willingness to walk.
Yes, George.
On the previous approval, item one talks about DOT. Has that been answered, Peter?
That was answered back in 2003 when the entrance only in the original plan was an entrance and an exit.
Right.
And during the review process, that was obviously changed to be an entrance only. So there were numerous issues but they did get their permits from DOT and before they opened up the first time around.
And the town engineer thinks that drainage is good. I remember issues of the shopping center to the south of this, and maybe here, I don't remember my memory, I don't know.
That
Silas Dean does not have adequate storm drainage or something like that. And is that still the case or not?
This site, the vast majority of the asphalt drains to a treatment system, which outlets to the wetlands in the back. There's probably a very small area at the driveway that might go out to the Silas Dean Highway, but the vast percentage of the site is controlled by the site and to the outlet in the back. So, and there is a stormwater treatment system under the parking lot in the back before the the drainage gets into the wetlands, so.
So it's not draining frontwards, it's draining mostly out back and
that's correct.
Right part.
Yep.
You're doing a weep off and you're really not pushing much or anything into the
Celestine
Highway.
Nope.
And you got enough green up there still to absorb?
Oh, yeah.
You feel?
Yes.
Because you haven't addressed this really when you talk about that kind of thing. Well, drainage and the ability to take care of the water on site.
Would this stormwater system and the detention system, which is generally behind CVS and extends between the two buildings, that's an underground detention system, and all of that was sized with these 23 spaces in mind. So the whole system was designed for this full build scenario.
With those in place.
And the night, the final night of the public hearing, the night the commission voted, one of the conditions was, would you eliminate those 23 spaces and hold them in reserve? And we did. But that we didn't change the storm drainage system. So all these years, the storm drainage system has been oversized.
Okay. I hear you. Thank you.
Dan, you want to
just... No, it's just that it was expected at some point they were going to come back. I mean, obviously, I wasn't on the commission at the time this was done. And I find it very difficult, you know, to create a problem now, especially since the commission originally wanted the 23 spaces. And as far as Rich is concerned, yeah, I think maybe it's not our regulations. I would hope not. I think it's more just it's the tenant mix. This is just too, you know, it wasn't envisioned. You were looking for a bank maybe at one point, as he was talking about. And if you have a bank, you're not going to have, you know, the type of noontime rush that you would have.
Right.
That it's protocol with the morning with the Starbucks. And I don't think they're going to conflict as far as parking. The times when they're busy are really different. It's lunch, it's dinner.
Lunch is their hot time. That's when they get a good crowd.
Yeah, I mean, and people tend to notice when they can't find a parking space and react accordingly by going somewhere else.
That's exactly what I was saying.
Also, if the tenants realize that they're having parking problems, they're going to have to, just by market force their employees to park in the rear of the building. I mean, if there's no parking, I mean, I suppose you could say we're going to require employees to park in the rear of the building, but I think that's a tenant concern rather than our concern, that the tenant's got to say, hey, I'm sorry, you want to work here, you got to park in the back.
Right.
Because we need customer parking, and it frees up 16 spaces, or however many.
Along that line, I assume there are rear doors to these?
All of them.
All of them, so employees could come in that way
yes.
if needed to park out back. There's plenty of room out there, that's for sure.
All right. So this is not a public hearing, but I would offer the opportunity. I think I saw you look. Are you part of this team?
No.
Would you like to comment?
Okay.
All right.
So I just had a question. Okay. So I just had a question about, Peter, your letter said that, so under the present parking regulations, we have 115 spaces that are required. So is that based on, even when you put in the new restaurant, because you know how sometimes you need additional spaces for?
Because it's a shopping center of 20,000 square feet or more, you do a gross parking rather than an individual breakout based on a restaurant versus retail. So that 115 is based on back when this was approved, I think, what was it, 150 or so were required. So when you change the regulations, you made some significant changes.
Okay.
Otherwise you can't build anything.
Tom?
So 115 are required. So if you add... So then you add another 23, is that it? So
yes.
So then you'd have like about 138 or something like that.
Well, this is
115 are required per the ratio in your zoning regulations.
Today. If you were to do it all over again.
So they proposed 160, so this is adding 20, three to that, so.
It says provided 183, required 92.
92, right.
Oh, on the, is this on the plan?
Yeah, that 92 is wrong.
Yeah. I assume this is what we're working off for what's going to be done rather than this little one?
The little one was simply what was approved.
What was approved, yep.
In 2003.
Yeah, as I said earlier, as part of any motion, I would include that, you know, a properly revised and compliant site plan be submitted to myself and the town engineer, where we'll make sure those ratios get accurately represented in the final plan.
Peter, what did you say the required is?
115.
115?
Yes.
So they're going to be 68
plus
over they proposed.
Yeah.
Just a question, do you know, in terms of that particular tenant, Chipotle, do you know, just curious, what the seating capacity is?
I do not.
Or the, what was in?
I can certainly find out, but I don't know.
I'm just curious.
They have odd seating arrangements in those places. I don't mean odd, but, you know, they're up on stools.
Yeah.
Stools. To be able to get the ambulance in there.
Be careful when you're going there, George.
All right, any more questions for the applicant, or shall we move on?
No, Joe, yeah, you had, but you answered.
You all set? All right. This is not a public hearing, so I guess we don't need a motion to close it or anything. Shall we just, anybody want to make a motion?
Make a motion, we approve the requested, well, is there a number on this? No. Requested amendment to application 1408-03Z to add 23 parking spaces and to add 16 parking spaces in the rear. It's only the 23 in the front.
Yeah, the 16 in the rear exist.
Okay.
Yep.
Substantially, as shown on the site plan, it was given to us with no date on it. You know, subject to correction and review by town planner and the town engineer.
You want to include the bullets from the town engineer?
Yeah, as outlined by the town engineer in memo of March 3rd, right? And that also includes the idea that they need a fully compliant site plan, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's item number one, so that topic really gets covered. So,
and also considering moving the southernmost parking spaces up a little bit to avoid the wooden guardrail.
Good point.
That covered, Pete?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's fine.
All right. Any additional thoughts, comments? Yolanda?
No, I'm just going to second that.
Would you second it for us?
I'd like to second that.
There, thank you very much. So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
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 Anyone opposed?
Opposed.
All right, Joe. All right, thank you very much.
Thank
Good luck.
You.
Okay. Item 4.2, discussion regarding the small cities application and fair housing action steps. I assume Peter or Denise?
Sure, there's a memorandum dated February 17th, 2017 in your packet. As part of a application submittal for a small cities grant for the Wethersfield Housing Authority, the application requires that the town consider there was a menu of suggested strategies aimed at taking a look at our fair housing situation. The town manager and I met and went through the options and identified several that we had to pick three that we wanted to pursue into the future. So first thing is it was suggested that we convene a stakeholders group to look at fair housing situations in town and maybe identify some changes. Also reviewing various ordinances, regulations, guidelines, etc., to also take a look at that in terms of whether we're being restrictive for families with children. And then potentially at the end of that process, take a look at whether there are zoning regulation amendments that we need to consider to implement the findings in those earlier strategies. So the town is moving forward in partnership with the Housing Authority. So if the funding is in fact granted, it will probably be granted with some of those caveats. So at some point in the not so distant future, I wanted you to be aware of that, just to make sure there's no strong feelings otherwise, so that when we are notified of the award, nobody is surprised at some of the conditions that might be applied to that financing. So so I just wanted to, you know, make sure it's in the record and you're aware of it, so that as we go forward, so whether it's the Planning and Zoning Commission or some other group convening the stakeholders remains to be seen. But nevertheless, I wanted to give you an FYI on that.
Do you have any reason to believe that our regulations are too restrictive for families with children?
No, I don't think so. You know, you have your SRD regulations do have some square footage limitations. Those may or may not be. I haven't really analyzed and compared those to other towns. There are, I think the minimum is, I shouldn't say that. It might be a 400 or 600 square foot limitation. So I've never really compared that to other towns to see how we rack and stack. But
the size of the
units. The size of the units. I mean, there are minimum square footage requirements, I believe, in the building code for certain rooms. I don't think we've ever sat down and took a look at those and added it all up to see how we compare to that. But
how would they deal with something like that if they ended up with some 500 square foot units? Or you determine that, or
we would just have to discuss whether, you know, we would need to consider any changes to some of those things. I don't think we have any other really specific occupancy requirements that I would be concerned about. You do allow, you know, accessory in-law apartments. I mean, that's a plus. You know, you have various sites in town that are already zoned multifamily and have numerous developments. So I think when you add all of those up, we don't meet the 10%, you know, affordable housing, but you're up there. I mean, I think you're close to 8% or something like that. So at the end of the day, I don't think, you know, there's going to be a glaring report that shows, you know, you've created these obstacles. But nevertheless, it's probably an exercise. I don't know that the town has ever gone through that exercise before. So it's an exercise probably worth going through, just to kind of assess where we are in comparison to other communities. So,
yeah, Peter, I'll bring up something from my past.
Is this personal or professional?
The night is young.
Yeah.
Is there one thing?
20 years ago, when I retired from the State Housing Department, in fact, they never gave us credit in town for our ownership of some of the family housing units. They were owned by the town of Wethersfield, rather than the state.
Okay.
The mortgage.
Yep.
And I never figured that out, but it wasn't a big deal that you had to meet that 10%. But I knew it was something that always kind of bothered me that they didn't do that.
Okay.
And so those are the kind of things I hope don't come up again at this late date, this many years later.
I've never analyzed, you know, what numbers they give us credit for versus what we have. So once again, it's probably worth doing that.
Yeah, we got so many more to come in place, including the accessory units and all that stuff.
But mm-hmm.
I don't know how many of those would be, considered low, moderate income units, CHFA,
mm-hmm.
and all that sort of thing.
Sure.
Okay.
I was just curious, who are the stakeholders that are going to be reviewing these?
I think that's up to us to determine that. Obviously, the building official, the fire marshal, probably our social services department, certainly staff from the planning department. We'd probably reach out, you know, to the Housing Authority, and there might be some, you know, community advocates for mm-hmm. for that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Maybe a developer or two. I think they leave that.
So you're still formulating?
Well, we haven't even started that. If they get the funding, then it'll be, we'll have to work all that out. I don't know if it's, you know, a formal thing where we have to report back to the state or not, but it might be an informal effort, but I think they would leave.
You don't think, therefore, it's worth going to another town that's gone through this?
It might be worth, if
talking to the staff.
Yeah, I'm a firm believer in not reinventing the wheel. If somebody else has gone through this, and I would be, you know, I wouldn't. Sure, we could certainly borrow from them and take a look at that.
Okay. Other questions? If not, shall we move on to the minutes? We have January 18th. And by the looks of it, we certainly have enough people here to vote on it.
Make a motion to approve January 18th minutes.
Any edits, George? You typically do.
Yeah, well, I'm making a motion. I thought Rich was, but I'm sorry.
He's apparently okay with it. You didn't catch anything? Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? So let me go down. There are one, two, myself, Rich, George, Tom, Ryan, Dan, and Yolanda. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven of the eight of us. No problem. February 7th minutes. Would somebody like to make a motion?
Make a motion to approve.
Two.
Second.
Thank you. One, two, three, four, five, six. There appear to be six of us. Myself, Rich, George, Ryan, Dan, and Yolanda. Mm-hmm. Six of us can vote on this. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right.
I'm a little concerned George hasn't found any errors in the minutes.
Yeah, I that's why I asked the first time, but I wasn't going to put him on the spot the second.
Unprecedented.
As long as the judge can read this stuff and understands it, that's all I really see.
You want the world.
Staff reports.
Just a couple of things to keep you in the loop. At last night's council meeting, the council approved granting additional funding for the design team for the screening at the high school. So they are finalizing the recommendations on that. I'm assuming they will be ready for your next meeting agenda for the review of that. They've also asked town staff to investigate the noise. Some of the noise issues coming off of the rooftop, and it appears, if you remember, that those torpedo-shaped protrusions,
as if public opinion.
Yes, which are, I guess, exhaust stacks from the chemistry labs.
Yep.
Apparently, the fans and whatever equipment is in there have been running continuously, and even when the labs are not being used, which was not intended, so they're trying to investigate what's going on with that, and so that seems to be generating a lot of the noise. So it looks like even without screening, if they can deal with that at the right, put it on a timer or whatever, that should address a lot of the neighbors' concerns about the noise. So you know, the fact that we've had these conversations has, otherwise it wouldn't have been further investigated. So
so it was on our agenda for last time round. So you're saying they're doing more homework now before they come?
Well, there
to
was
us?
An issue with the contract with the architect and proceeding with the final plans with that. So it was kind of a chicken and egg situation where they had to go back and get additional purchase order expanded for the architect. So that was resolved last night. It had been tabled from the previous council meeting, so it had been delayed, and last night got through that process. So I'm assuming they will try and be in front of you at your next meeting in 2 weeks or so. Yeah. The other thing is the Ridge Road apartment complex. If you saw the memo in the file from the fire marshal, there will be a neighborhood meeting Thursday night at 7 p.m. in this room to discuss the need to do some blasting. They found more ledge in a limited area they tried to remove, but couldn't without blasting. The town ordinance on blasting requires a neighborhood notice and a meeting, so they are going through that process I talked to the fire marshal today, and he hadn't gotten any phone calls, so I'm not sure. I mean, blasting these days is done in a very controlled way, so, but nevertheless, just so you know, there will be some blasting up there. If you're interested, we can certainly keep you posted on when it's happening if you wanted to see that in the field, but you should also know about that. And then,
Peter, just a quick question. How come engineers and contractors don't know about that kind of stuff? Don't they do?
They did. Alley? They did test. They did borings. They did, but they, you know, you, they didn't. They don't do them in every single. You know, they space them out. And also, I think this particular scenario, when they revised the plans to try and get the roof elevation down, they, you know, were going to go deeper into the ground in order to accommodate that and address those concerns. So I think both of those factors ended up, you know, creating this situation. Yeah, they can't, you know exactly where the depth is all the time. And I think they thought some of the rock could be handled with, you know, standard equipment without having to blast. And then lastly, I did provide you with a copy of my report that I presented to town council last night. So if you see anything on there that you have a question, there are about 40 different things on this list. So there's lots of activity going on. The Church Street Clearinghouse Auction Gallery project is working its way through the design review committee. The design review committee has asked for some changes to the treatment of the new building, as well as more details on the improvements to the existing brick building. So they're giving that project a pretty high degree of scrutiny. So they're going back to design review, hopefully, yeah, a couple of weeks.
The second meeting with them?
This is second or third? Second meeting. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, they have. Yep. Yep.
Cedar Mountain?
Cedar Mountain Stone and Mulch. They are, there was an outstanding zoning issue there, but at the same time, they are looking to probably submit a plan to also expand as well. So they went to ZBA because they were storing things in the front yard and other things, and ZBA did grant that. We do hear that the town of Newington may have some strong comments on that project at the time that it comes in. So just an FYI on that.
What's the one above that?
Yeah. The one above
station.
That.
Is that on the corner?
That's the corner of Arrow, yeah, across from Cumberland.
Directly across from Cumberland Farms?
Yeah, it's like the McDonald's Burger King theory that.
The barbecue man?
Yeah, that corner.
Giving up that spot?
Yep, he's long gone.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, does DOT ever take a stand or something like that? I mean, that's a serious area right in there with the backup going over to 175 from the Berlin Turnpike. And
you're talking about for Cedar Stone?
Will they ever?
No, he's talking about for the gas station, too.
So, yeah,
because I'll comment like crazy on it.
So, I mean, generally speaking, you know,
go through there.
If you have legal access to the highway, you can put whatever fits, but we'll control the access point. You know, so it's supposed to be a combination of the land use agency and the town, and then DOT works with them afterwards. It's kind of, you know, they're supposed to work hand in glove, but the land use board happens first. And if the land use board gives them approval, DOT works with them, you know, to make sure the traffic works okay. But if you have legal access, you know, along the highway, and and the state hasn't purchased your access through, you know, a right-of-way transaction, then, you know, you're allowed to have an access point. Which, you know, even, you know, the one that we were talking about last time, you know, to me, when I look at that, I kind of cringe from a DOT perspective, but at no point in history did, you know, the state of Connecticut ever buy access along the frontage. And you know, so then you're stuck allowing them to have access. If there's nothing else.
Not to prolong anything, but.
Hey, George did all night, so go ahead.
Yeah, I know. The small cities application, you know, and talking about reviewing regulations and so forth reminded me, I mean, I'm glad that we're busy and you guys are busy with new projects and new applications and stuff, but we have, you know, kind of a backlog of housekeeping regulation stuff, and I was wondering if there was any way that you could find like an intern or somebody at UConn Law to sort of move those along so that, you know, they would get done, but they wouldn't compete with you spending time on, you know, revenue generating projects.
Consultant work, Rich?
Well, just things, yeah, I mean, somebody, like an intern kind of thing. I mean, somebody who can spend the time to put together the camper regulations so that, you know, next winter when things are slow, we're not saying, oh, crap, I wish we had done this a year ago. I mean, probably takes as much time to find somebody to do it and oversee them as it would to do it yourself. But
yeah, an intern's probably not the solution. I mean, you'd need, if you had like a retired, you know, planner or somebody like that, and you could throw some resources towards it to, you know, have the time to do it. I mean, the sign project is complicated.
Yeah.
You need a real...
Nobody wants to touch
it. You almost need a town attorney to work on that, but we are...
A First Amendment lawyer who's got plenty of spare time.
We are... Yeah, right.
Thanks.
Right.
No, but some of the universities, you know, have planning programs, and I know that there are kids who are in those programs going for master's degrees and other who will be looking for intern work, low-cost, but experience. Things like signs, the campers. I'm concerned. You said the campers. I am. But I'm more concerned about the signs.
Signs, right.
That, to me, is going to
blow up. Somebody will sue us over that.
Yeah.
Right.
We're gonna get, that's going to blow up in our face.
Mm-hmm.
And it's happening all over the country. And the sooner we do it, electronic signs is a good example. Mm-hmm. We had all those discussions about the electronic signs, and all of a sudden we're going to be popping up all over the place, and we have no control over it.
Right. Yeah, I was waiting and hoping that another town got a little bit ahead of us, and then we could, you know, beg, borrow, and steal, but it hasn't really happened yet. A couple towns have talked about it. Newington actually was beginning to go through that. I don't know how comprehensively they got into their sign regulations, but you would need a, you know, you would almost need a, you know, master's degree or JD, you know, student for the sign. You know, you need somebody who really, you know, takes a look at some of the cases and some of the model regulations and then applies them to ours. I mean, I've probably gotten 50% of the way with that, with the sign one, but it needs to be pushed further given what's going on in town. And if somebody has a suggestion for somebody that we can recruit, by all means, I would put an effort into trying to do that. You know, I could supervise somebody if they had, you know, some wherewithal, not your standard intern or another professional, if we could carve out some resources. And
if there are other towns that are in a similar situation where it's a second tier issue, can we share resources, you know, regionalization, you know?
It would be a great thing for, you know, one of the regional planning agencies or council of governments to take on as a project, as a model. I haven't seen that yet. I have found some models from other states, and you know, I was using those to kind of move the effort along. But yeah, if one of those entities could, you know, come up with you know, a model that we could sort of plug in and make some changes, that would be helpful. But I haven't heard that conversation going on amongst some of our.
Are there any schools in the area that have planning programs?
Well, Central has a, you know, geography and sort of planning concentration. Occasionally there's a UConn, you know, law student or something like that.
Yeah, Sarah Bronin teaches a couple classes in that.
Right, but
maybe that we should reach out to there as a, not saying that's an answer, but it's a possibility.
Sure.
Because it would be less expensive
than
going out and retaining. So that's going to be expensive. There's just no way.
Yes, it is going to be expensive. So, yeah, if anyone has any suggestions, I would be more than happy to, you know, names that I could follow up. I would certainly do that. it would be helpful to me.
All right. Anything else?
No, I won't ask anything else.
The only other thing is the CFPZA dinner is at the AquaTurf on March 23rd. I already have Rich and Tom. I don't know if anyone else is interested in attending. Let me know.
I think four ZBA members. We don't want to have ZBA have more members attending than us, do we?
Well, we should have enough that they have to sit at a different table.
So we don't spend the evening growling at them?
Right.
Do we have an agenda yet? Do we know who's speaking? What the topic is?
The topic is FOI.
It's like texting during meetings.
Texting, yeah.
Unheard of.
All right. Have a motion, please.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Thank you, Ryan. All those in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
I'll assume there's no opposed.
Chairman of West Hartford. Texted him. He was like, hey, when you guys have to make a change to regulations, he's like, oh, the core counsel's office would have to get that's probably something a lawyer would know.
Court counsel, yeah. I don't even know. What? Court counsel.
In my design.